This video is continuing in our series on multiple linear regression. We now have worked our way up to unique intercepts and slopes. So we're going to specify both unique intercepts and unique slopes. The way you'd probably just think about this is we're going to have different lines through the data for each level of some categorical explanatory variable. It's just different lines. So multiple linear regression, I think you're starting to see, because of the generality here, is really like the tool behind many of the worlds of statistics models. Many of the models of statistics rely somehow on the framework developed in the understanding of multiple linear regression. So we are starting to figure out how to incorporate multiple explanatory variables to predict one numerical response variable, such that the number of estimated parameters, think of like all the different coefficients that might be incorporated in your model, such that the number of estimated parameters is less than your sample size. As long as that holds, then we can incorporate basically as many numerical and categorical explanatory variables as you want. So for now, we're only going to focus on one categorical and one numerical explanatory variable for simplicity. It's my opinion that as long as you have this understanding down of how the categorical and numerical explanatory variables can be included in a multiple linear regression model, then you could very easily extend this to include multiple categorical or multiple numerical explanatory variables. But we'll start with just one of each. So we're going to get a picture to motivate the idea, and then we will fit an example in R. So the world we are imagining is trying to fit across some numerical explanatory variable. We're trying to predict a numerical response variable. And the way we're to think about this is we have data for, let's say, level A of some categorical explanatory variable, and separately we have data for some level B of some numerical explanatory variable. Now what we are to imagine is then that there is one line that fits through the data for the categorical explanatory variable B, and there is one line that fits across the numerical explanatory variable X for the categorical level A, categorical explanatory variables level A. So as you see, we have two unique lines, one for each level of the categorical explanatory variable. The way we write this out in order to predict y hat is we'd have some intercept, and that always goes to the first alphabetical level of the categorical explanatory variable. That shows up whether you're trying to make predictions for observations from level A or B. And then we have an offset relative to the level B. B here is an indicator variable that will indicate one if you're trying to make a prediction for observations from level B. Then we have a new coefficient across the numerical explanatory variable X, and that will always show up whether or not you're trying to make a prediction for observations from level A or B. And then last, we have a coefficient times the indicator variable for B times the numerical explanatory variable X. Now let's try to break this down as we did before, where if you're trying to make a prediction for observations from level A, you will always have the intercept for level A. The indicator variable for level B will be 0, so you will not have beta 1 in your predictions. You will get beta 2 times x. And again, for the last term, the indicator variable B will be 0, so that term will entirely drop out of your model. Here is the unique line we would get for predictions for observations from level A. We can do the same thing for B. If you're going to make predictions for observations from level B, you would have the intercept, even though it's for level A, you'd include that here, as always, for the intercept, plus your indicator variable for B would indicate as 1, so you'd have a unique intercept for observations from level B as the combination of beta naught plus beta 1. And you see that would get you this unique intercept for the line for observations from level B. Plus, now B2 always shows up, but I'm going to hold off on writing the X for a similar grouping reason that we saw for the intercepts. So B2 always shows up, even though, it just always shows up. And then because we're making predictions for observations from level B, the indicator B will indicate 1. And since both B3 and B2 are multiplied by x, I'm going to lump them together such that the unique slope for the line for observations from level B is the combination of beta 2 plus beta 3. So in fact, here is one line for predictions for observations from level B. The intercept happens to be the sum of beta naught and beta 1, and the slope for level B happens to be the sum of beta 2 and beta 3. This is the full general way we can incorporate categorical and numerical explanatory variables. As long as you have this understanding, which I think really comes from being able to write down the model with numerical and categorical variables appropriately, as long as you have this understanding, then you should be able to extend this idea to any number of categorical and numerical explanatory variables. For now, we're going to keep in this world with just one categorical and one numerical explanatory variable, but let's jump into R to see what it looks like in code. So I'm starting as we have previously, where we're going to load our favorite libraries these days. I'm going to use the dataset finches from my GitHub repository named data, where the username is my last name. And it turns out that from this code for simple linear regression, the unique intercepts and slopes version of multiple linear regression is really easy to get pictures in the world of ggplot. All you need to do is add a color argument by the categorical explanatory variable you want, and then maintain this geome smooth within it. And that means the geome smooth part will draw a linear model one line for each island that we're going to color the points and the lines by. I think it's more obvious in this picture now that these lines do not share an intercept and do not share a slope. They are unique slopes and unique intercepts lines for the levels of the categorical explanatory variable island, each across the numerical explanatory variable middle toe length. Okay, to fit this model in R, we will continue to use the function lm for linear model. We're going to try to predict the numerical response variable beak width by the combination of island cross, that is asterisk right there, as if you're multiplying the levels of island by the numerical explanatory variable middle toe length. It's fairly quick for R to fit this model, and we can extract the coefficients with the function coef. And let's look at those, because I think this is where it really helps us to understand that to make predictions of beak width, we will always have an intercept, even though it happens to be negative, which doesn't quite make sense in this context. That's okay. That doesn't mean this model is bad. It just means we don't have any data near zero, is all that really means. So we start with the intercept, beta 1, and then we have beta 2, which times San Cristobal. So that is an indicator variable for finches from the island San Cristobal, and an offset relative to the intercept for finches from Floriana. Then we go beta 3 times Santa Cruz. Santa Cruz is the indicator variable for finches from the island Santa Cruz. Beta 3 is the offset relative to the base intercept. And the base intercept, again, is for finches from the island Floriana. So beta 3 is relative to the base intercept, because if you're trying to make predictions for finches from the island Santa Cruz, San Cristobal is 0, and you'd add together beta 1 plus beta 3. This model has a few more terms in it, so let's just keep it going. Beta 4 here is the slope across middle toe length, specifically for finches from the island Floriana, but in fact, because there are no further levels, no further indicator variables multiplied by this term, this will show up in every specific line, no matter which island the birds show up from. But beta 4 by itself is the slope across middle toe length for finches from Floriana. And we'll go plus beta 5 times, and now I'm looking at this term, so I'll just make this easy. San Cristobal, the indicator variable for finches from the island San Cristobal, times middle toe length. We've got one last term in this model, beta 6, which is this term. And again, I'm just going to copy and paste so you don't have to watch me struggle through spelling middle toe length yet again. And in the end, here is our complete model with categorical and one categorical and one numerical explanatory variable. And we've appropriately included indicator variables wherever necessary, such that we can get the right predictions whenever we know from which island a finch came. So we could, for instance, make a prediction for, let's say, we always need to incorporate the intercept. Okay, let's try to be specific about this. This will be for a finch from San Cristobal with middle toe length of 19. Okay, so we're going to incorporate 1 for the intercept. This bird is from San Cristobal, so San Cristobal will indicate 1. Santa Cruz will indicate 0, since this finch is from San Cristobal. Now we're up to beta 4, which is always going to show up, even though we're making predictions for finches from San Cristobal. So it'll be 19, because that'll be the placeholder for middle toe length. And then for coefficient 5, beta 5, we are making a prediction for a finch from the island San Cristobal. So we'll have a 1 times 19. So it'll just be 1 times 19. And then a 0, because we are not making a prediction for a finch from the island Santa Cruz. And indeed, we would predict a finch from the island San Cristobal with a middle toe length of 19 centimeters to have a beak width of 10.54 centimeters. As before, we could incorporate all of these predictions into our data frame by applying across, by applying across the rows of the model matrix X, the function that takes a row and adds together beta times the row. And if we wanted to make a plot from this, in fact, all we would be doing is recreating this plot, we could put middle toe length on the x-axis, beak width on the y-axis, color the points by island, add points, add a line where the aesthetic puts y-hat on the y-axis, and there is that recreated plot done on our own. But you saw it's pretty much easier just to go through GeoSmooth. Anyway, we're going to continue on where in this last example, we will do confidence intervals for both individual coefficients and predictions on the y-axis. So let's go boot multiple linear regression because now this is very general. Our function will take in a data set and an index. We're basically just going to return the coefficients from the fitted model above where we remember to resample the data itself. We'll call boot on our original data set. And we'll calculate this 1,001 times. This might start getting a little bit more difficult for some of our computers, but it went pretty quick on mine. Let's see, we're in calculated confidence interval from the object B. Let's start with our example here. Let's do, so we certainly want type equals to percent and index equals to, which one would be good for us to do? So we've already done a slope in a previous video. Let's do index 3, which will be 1, 2, and 3. So this will be the offset 4 finches from Santa Cruz relative to finches from Floriana. Okay, that was pretty quick. That's fantastic. Now you got to remember this offset is specific to the y-axis. It's like the offset relative for the intercept. Now, if you want to see why that is, we chose index 3. That is 1, 2, and 3. That is this a confidence interval on this coefficient. So that's as if middle toe length is equal to 0. And all we're interpreting is this coefficient. That is the difference in the y-intercept for finches from the island Santa Cruz relative to the island Floriana. Okay, let's give it a go. We are 95% confident that when middle toe length is equal to 0, we expect finches from the island Santa Cruz to have a beak width larger than finches from the island Floriana by between negative, you can, yes, be larger by a negative number, negative 7.1 and 13.1 centimeters. Okay, one more time, through and through. We are 95% confident that when middle toe length, these are intercept offsets all the way down here, when middle toe length is equal to zero, we expect finches from the island Santa Cruz to have a beak width larger than finches from the island Floriana by somewhere between negative 7.1 and positive 13.1 centimeters. So what it's really telling us is that the difference between finches' beak width when middle toe length is zero is somewhere between a negative and a positive number. We really don't have great certainty on the difference between beak widths for finches from the island Santa Cruz relative to the island Floriana when middle toe length is zero. But I'm not particularly concerned about that because, well, we don't have any data near middle toe lengths equal to zero, which is invariably what's giving us poor estimates for intercepts. All of our data is basically from 15 and up. We have no data down here near zero. So these intercepts, or the intercept offsets, are really quite uninformative in this case. Nonetheless, that is a proper interpretation. Let's see if we can do just one more. Boot.cib type equals percent, index equals 2. Let's go for the last one, 6, because why not? So this is a confidence interval on this coefficient, but really this is a slope offset compared to beta 4, the base slope for finches from Floriana. We are 95% confident that for every 1 centimeter increase in middle toe length, the increase in beak width for finches from the island Santa Cruz is greater than the increase in beak width for finches from the island Floriana by between negative 0.7 and positive 0.4 centimeters. Okay, we got to take a minute to make sure we understand what this one is actually telling us. It's telling us that the relative difference in the increase in beak width for every 1 centimeter increase in middle toe length is somewhere between negative 0.7 and positive 0.4 for finches from the island Santa Cruz relative to finches from the island Floriana. If that's all too much, what we need to recognize is that the difference in slopes for finches from the island Santa Cruz is relative to the data. We're not sure if it's negative or positive. The difference in the slope for finches on the island Santa Cruz relative to the finches on the island Floriana is somewhere between negative 0.7 and positive 0.4. Because we don't even know if the difference in the slope is positive or negative, we're not really sure that these are separate lines. Consider the graph over here on the right. Look at these two slopes, here the one in the middle, and here the one on the bottom. Those are nearly, at least within the space of the data we have, those are very similar lines. In fact, our uncertainty represented in those lines is so great that we can't differentiate those lines to see that the difference is strictly positive or strictly negative. All we're saying is that the difference is somewhere in between negative numbers and positive numbers, possibly capturing zero. If instead we looked at the difference in the slope for San Cristobal. Well, apparently there's a lot of error around that one too. Okay, fine. We can go about making bootstrap predictions as well. It would work very similar to before. And let's see if I can center this a little bit better. Where we first fit the model, resampling the data as appropriate. Then we calculate our coefficients, store them, and then use those to multiply beta times some vector x. And we will take that vector x as an argument to the function. The only thing you really got to remember here is x needs to be a vector of the same length as beta. So we could bootstrap predictions then. Whoops. Okay, so let's keep the context we used before, where we're going to bootstrap predictions for a bird from San Cristobal with a middle toe length of 19. So we would say, we are 95% confident that when a finch from San Cristobal has middle toe length of 19 centimeters, we expect the beak width to be between 10 and 11.1 centimeters. Oh, the predictions aren't so bad, even if interpreting the coefficients is not simple. Okay, so we have explored here how to incorporate both categorical and numerical explanatory variables in the model. It's not the easiest to interpret some of these coefficients, though it can be done with enough patience. But what is relatively nice out of this is that you can get out confidence intervals for predictions unique to each island for any numerical value that you want.